I need to start with a question.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. How did you come with the idea of researching rivers?
Okay, well,
rivers. As an archaeologist, I mean.
Right, okay. Well, rivers are normally considered to be a natural entity. So actually, the archaeology of rivers is what you might call an anachronism, to use your terminology. Uh-huh. So many people said while I was writing the book that it was an odd thing to do. How can there be an archaeology of rivers? And I kind of like that. I like that ambiguity or contradiction. But actually, you can have an archaeology of rivers. There's a hidden archaeology in all rivers. There's no such thing as a natural river. Really, my book was trying to develop the idea that rivers are kind of entanglements of nature and culture. They're like a sort of confluence of cultural and natural forces. So it would be foolish, I argued, if you just looked at rivers from a geomorphological point of view, you know, in terms of erosion and sedimentation. You have to consider how people are shaping and using rivers as well, and how rivers kind of run like a thread through people's lives and through human history as well. So why do you ask the question, Chus? Why are you interested in rivers?
I am. I think I'm part of the group of the curatorial team of the Istanbul Biennial, and we are concerned, I think, or we are considering to produce a school or a meeting or a something which is related to the issue of water.
Right.
But I found it really difficult to just relate to water as a substance or a fluid.
Yeah.
And then when I was reading the material and your articles, I found an impressive inspiration in the fact that you just consider the river as a way of relating this kind of natural discourses with the cultural discourses, but in a place that is not really obvious. Which is the river. But then this place is not a place, and it is. I think it's not, because it's like some kind of almost an event in nature or an event in the surface of Earth.
Or perhaps a process.
Yeah, exacto. Yeah. And then there is like, this, you know, this kind of interrelation with the life of the human communities that are surrounding the river. So I thought it really interesting, the whole approach that you actually tried to to propose. And and also when I was invited to the Anthropocene, apart from knowing that human life has an impact that transforms Earth, not only materially speaking, geographically speaking, and so on, it also, you know, it's very difficult to exactly know what we are talking about. So I thought that you're proposing archaeology as a meeting point of all these kind of fields of knowledge that they don't exactly know what to do with a new era was interesting.
Well, I think you're right that it's very difficult to think of water just as a substance, but the thing about rivers is that they're really something much more than that. And so if one's thinking, for example, about the agency of rivers and how rivers act on people and things and on the landscape, water itself, water in this bottle, yes, it has an agency of sorts, but it's not really doing much or affecting anything. But the water in a river is totally different, because it's got this flow running through it, and that flow is related. It's a kind of expression, if you like, of the forces of the earth and indeed of the sun, because the whole hydrological cycle is driven by the sun, the energy of the sun, and the downward movement of water to the sea in a river is driven in part by the gravity of the earth pulling the water downwards. So when you put your hand into a river and you feel the water flowing, you are actually in touch with these kind of, if you like, cosmic forces. So a river is much more than it seems to be, and just looking at one little bit of river can help you understand much larger systems.
So. And what's the most surprising thing you discovered looking at rivers?
All sorts of surprising things happen and emerge from rivers once you start looking at them as partly cultural entities. The thing is that normally we're not looking at rivers in that way. We see them as kind of natural things. But actually there's a hidden archaeology there. And so features can emerge. And a wonderful way of looking at rivers, as well as directly through fishing in them or swimming in them, which is one way. But you can combine that with something like Google Earth, where you can look down, as it were, from space, and then you can zoom in, and you can actually, as it were, virtually fly along the river course and follow its meanderings and study it that way. And when you do that, you can see things from the air, under the water, perhaps on the riverbed. You know, weirs, other human constructions that, you know, you just wouldn't, you would have assumed weren't there, but they are there once you start looking for them. So the whole world of rivers kind of opens up to you once you start looking at them in that particular way. And it's almost like there's a whole field of archaeology waiting to be discovered.
Yeah, but it's really interesting because for those like me that we know nothing about archaeology, you kind of imagine it being the knowledge of discovering things deep down, like, you know, to create this strata, the prototypical view on archaeology. When I was reading your text and now that I'm listening to your description of the rivers, I kind of discover another archaeology, like just not going down but going up, or looking from a perspective that also encompasses the atmospheric point of view, so to say. And that was super surprising to me, like where you are proposing archaeology as a method or as a new discovery on our understanding of the different materials and therefore intelligences. Sorry, this is like only so that could happen to me.
I think it's certainly true that you see, the thing is about rivers is that they're not solid like you'd expect. You'd expect archaeology to focus on solid things like stratigraphy, like your buried strata, like rocks and soils and boundaries between them. But rivers aren't like that. They're fluid things, and they move around not only in the sense that they flow, but they also kind of meander from side to side. And even the meanders kind of shift downstream in a kind of snake-like fashion. So applying archaeology to such a fluid thing actually challenges the ideas of what archaeology is. But the fundamental point is that rivers are a part of human material culture in the sense that they've been shaped by human beings, and really radically shaped. You know, people have expended a lot of effort in redirecting rivers, dredging rivers, making rivers deeper, and, you know, putting the energy of rivers to work. But at the same time, the river isn't entirely like other bits of material culture in that it's partly wild as well. So you have that kind of wildness of rivers, which comes out in floods and unexpected events, and also the sheer danger of rivers. You know, they have a dangerous aspect to them. And I think that makes them really good to think with, because they're kind of quite subversive things. So, you know, rivers can suddenly overflow and flood, and they can wash away all these cultural forms. You know, if you think of like floods in Florence and other places, you know, they can destroy things and wash things away. But, and then they go back to their normal course, which is fairly constrained and influenced by human beings and so on. But just occasionally they come out and they have this capacity to, you know, to kind of undermine culture. And I think that's, that makes them good things to think with, I think.
No, I was like thinking, you know, one of the problems that I do have with the Anthropocene question is that it seems that it's still kind of formalized in the modernistic view that there is, you know, it's nature, and nature was at the beginning. You know, I'm simplifying it. But it's like nature was at the beginning, and nature did have power over us. And then little by little, historically, we gain power over nature. And then now we are in the Anthropocene era where we gain power over nature. And then here we are, and we need to evaluate what this power is and what's the impact of it and so on. So I found really interesting that when you are talking about archaeology, you are kind of making it in such a way that it's producing a doubt on that view.
I think so. It does.
It's first of all because you are kind of concern with the superimposition of theory in the field of analyzing exactly that narrative. Second, and this is not something that you are concerned with, but I've been concerned with, for example, you know, the point of singularity, for example, like when technology or artificial intelligence would put also, you know, is this narrative that something would take over and something would take over and something would take over. But when you're talking about archaeology as a meeting point and then the rivers, it seems that there is somebody that is not taking over. There is an intelligence that is present in water, is making decisions, and it's kind of relating to nature as if it's not culture, it's kind of beyond it, but it's also kind of thinking at the same time.
I wouldn't actually say that rivers have an agency in that sense, that they're kind of intending effects. But I would say that they definitely have a kind of agency. But I certainly agree with you that rivers help to challenge the idea of nature and culture. Not only our kind of way of thinking about nature and culture in space and in the way we categorize objects and things and animals and so on, but also in time as well. And as you say, the Anthropocene does embody this notion that we lived in a kind of natural world.
Yeah, completely.
And then that at some point things flip over into a cultural world. So it's almost as though you have human beings and their cultures and technologies living within a natural environment, so that they're surrounded and enclosed by natural forms. And now we're starting to think of things differently, that nature can actually be inside culture and is increasingly becoming kind of enclosed by human effects and influences and forms. But so it's like a kind of radical inversion. But I think there's a fundamental flaw in that way of thinking, because there's a sense in which we've always been a kind of, just like rivers, we've always been a sort of hybrid reality of nature and culture.
Completely.
We've never been cultural beings separate from nature.
But don't you think, and that's exactly what you are claiming with our relationship with theory, Do you think that we still lack, you know, an imagination of this hybridity and also vocabulary of it? I think even in this gathering, I think it's kind of commonsensical that by the fact that we are many and that we duplicate and that the industrial revolution, technological revolution, informational revolution, data revolution, it's kind of, it gives this quantitative view on the whole thing without actually, you know, does it really matter that much? And if it does, it needs to be read in negative terms, or if there's any other way of narrating that time, because it seems that everything is in the timeline. We have been in a time, and then now we are into another time that came after that time. Well, but you are an archaeologist. I think things don't happen that way, no?
No. Well, actually, it's really funny that you should raise that question, because in the practices session, which follows this later this evening, so after the exchanges, Frank Libovici, who's a poet, has challenged us to think of different ways of visualizing the start of the Anthropocene.
Mm-hmm.
So, and we're actually going to try and work out, so he was concerned with exactly the same thing as you. He was saying that, well, we've got this model of a geological timeline, and are we just adding another rectangle on the end?
Yeah.
Or can we think of it in different ways? And the trouble with that timeline and just adding a rectangle on, it sort of implies that you have to have an event where one period ends and the other one begins. But actually, there are different ways of thinking about it. And you can think of the Anthropocene more as a process that doesn't have any one point that you can call the beginning, but kind of unfolds through time and in a sort of time transgressive way.
But still interesting, I think if you study art history at school, the first book, or at the university, the first book that they put on the table is Henri Faucillon, which is the guy that kind of invented, quote unquote, the eras, no? The Renaissance, the modern era, and so on and so forth. So because it's a way of ordering, and it's a way of...
Yeah. And it's a terrific construction, isn't it? It's an edifice of boxes, essentially.
And isn't it that we are still following that logic, I think, of... My problem with the whole is not the facts, because the facts can be narrated in different forms, but it's the conception of time that is running through our heads when we are actually referring to Anthropocene or Holocene or to Renaissance or Baroque or modern, is that we cannot get rid of the befores and afters as ways of cause-effect. And then, of course, because we are causing damage on nature, then we are perpetrators and so on. And then all of a sudden it becomes like... banal somehow, important and banal at the same time, and moralistic in a way that is not adding complexity but kind of moving away from it.
And really we should think about different ways of visualizing time, and not just visualizing, because I think that we're too constrained by vision, and we tend not to think about it in terms of other bodily senses as well. And so instead, what normally happens is that you have your time bar, and it's in a diagram, and it's in a text. So it's two-dimensional for a start, and I think you would have to make it three-dimensional. And the other thing about texts and diagrams is that although we try and put time into them through our words, there's actually no time in there at all. It's like just a static thing. And so in thinking about time and another way of presenting it, you have to kind of introduce time somehow. Mm-hmm. So you have to add that fourth dimension of time. And this is exactly what we're going to try and do in our practice session afterwards. We're going to introduce a different way of thinking about the onset of the Anthropocene, which isn't just that two-dimensional, timeless perspective. I know it sounds strange to say timeless in relation to a timescale, but it's just a kind of textual thing. It's just a diagram on the page. We've somehow got to bring that to life. And I really hope you'll be able to... Will you be able to be there later this evening?
Yeah, I think so.
That's great, because...
it just really makes me think a lot. I think it's very difficult to relate to it when you are not close to the field, as I am not. But
sure.
I was thinking, like, you know, you talk about culturated ground, and you talk about, you know, all what we did somehow becomes a matter that has been touched by culture and history and time.
Yes.
And then archaeology could be the field studying it.
Yeah.
But in what about information or technology? Like, would you include that into it? I think would
Absolutely.
Be that one of your rivers?
Yeah, that archaeology can be applied to digital technology and digital objects, and can even extend into the virtual world. So there are some archaeologists actually working, like I know one girl who was working on Second Life, for example, as an archaeologist. And so I think archaeology is something that...
And what is archaeology helping us to understand?
Right, well, I think that it is a way of looking at the material world in a kind of surprising or different way. I'm applying it to the present here, because I think that archaeology applies not just to the past. I mean, most of the work I do is actually related to the distant past. But I'm also involved in a kind of archaeology of the contemporary world, which is almost like a new field and a developing field. And it's very much out of that that, you know, an archaeology of the Anthropocene emerges, I think. So we had a kind of session in a conference last year on archaeology of the Anthropocene. And we had archaeologists from all over the world came and contributed to that. And this is coming back to your term of anachronism. I think this is a really good example of an anachronistic thing, because archaeology is supposed to be about the past. It's supposed to be about old things, but actually you can apply it to the present and the future. But when you do, or to the unfolding present, but when you do, it has this anachronistic flavor to it. It's like something out of one time put into applied to another time. And that makes it interesting. And it always generates different perspectives. So,
but what's so to understand, I think, what would be the difference in between if you have a historian of science or a technology and an archaeologist and a philosopher, the three of them talking about a computer as an object, what would be the perspective that archaeology is adding or is bringing that the other two cannot see?
An archaeologist would, compared to a philosopher or a historian of science, we're much more materialistic than that. So we're like interested in artefacts and objects and in excavating sites. So we'd be interested in excavating a computer, for example. That sounds silly, but in the very act of doing that, you would actually find out things that you didn't know about computers, precisely because you're applying a different perspective upon it. But the materialistic approach is not it's not like a trite thing or a trivial thing. You can work out typologies of computers, and you can use those typologies or typological schemes to date layers. So where you have computers dumped in landfill deposits, for example, or computer components dumped in, these can all be dated, and they can be used to date layers of landfill in quarries that have been mm-hmm. filled in. But we're not thinking of them as old things or things that have been discarded. We're thinking of them as things that have both a future and a past. So if you take, for example, a landfill deposit, and you have lots of computer components and electrical components dumped in that mm-hmm. deposit, that has a past which you can uncover through excavation or through examining the material. But there's also a future there, because it's quite likely that these objects, these materials, are going to be quite valuable in the future, some of them. There mm-hmm. are heavy metals in there that will be useful. And these landfill deposits might well be mined in the future. So these objects, when they are buried in the ground, they're not necessarily dead and buried. They might... The archaeological layers, I call it the archaeosphere.
Yeah.
But
I was about to ask you about that, because it's an amazing, interesting term.
But it's a layer that isn't, you know, it's anachronistic again, because it sounds as though it's about old things. And people say, well, we're not interested in archaeology because it's about the past, and it can't apply to anything like the Anthropocene. But actually, the archaeosphere is a layer that's still very much in the process of formation. So if you just drive around Berlin or around Basel or anywhere in Spain or in England, you'll see this in action. You'll see the transformation of the surface of the earth taking place with machines mm-hmm. digging development sites and construction sites. And so on, and not just in developed countries, but in the developing world too. And the whole surface of the earth is being transformed, and the archaeosphere, what I call the archaeosphere, which is like the anthropogenic layer that sits on top of the earth, it's kind of growing both upwards and downwards and laterally mm-hmm. as well. And it's becoming like a force and a presence in its own right. So it's, you know, it's actually, it's not just a record of the past. It's something that everything that humans do is contingent upon it. Because,
yeah.
you know, even here today, we're kind of sitting, everything, all these people here, we're all on top of the archaeosphere, which provides the platform for this building, and if you dug down here, you'd find it.
Yeah, but it's also an interesting approach that kind of goes away from geography views or more landscape readings of this transformation, yeah. which yeah. is really interesting, because the discourse mm. in the 90s, and I'm of course going back to the art, was yeah. dominated by the city. The city yes. was the place that was growing, was also yeah. the place where it was supposed, the production was supposed to happen. And yeah. all the studies concentrate in trying to understand this new entity, the yeah. city. And yeah. urbanism was mm. like the kind of, it was the tool that was given to us.
Yes.
And yeah. then, of course, contemporary art was very part of it, because it introduces mm. both action, like action in the time of the now,
yeah.
politics,
yeah. Yeah.
politics and aesthetics,
yeah.
that they were always together and so on. But then when you are like saying, I think I'm polemizing, but I think that it's mm. very interesting that you are saying, okay, forget about that. And then yeah. if you just look at it under the point yeah. of view of archaeology, yeah. you would discover a much complex reality into yeah. this kind of concentration and densification of both matter cultural action that may happen mostly in the city, but also outside the cities. And
I think it very much happens not only in the city, but, you know, if you go into London, for example, you can find quite deep deposits of this stuff, you know, like 8 meters deep, sometimes even up to 30 meters deep on the Olympic site, where they actually filled in, you know, deep docks and things like that. But out in the country, it's the, you know, cities only cover about 3% of the terrestrial surfaces of the earth. But it's out in the country that you get this real lateral extent of anthropogenically modified ground in the form of things like plough soils, and in the Far East, rice paddy fields in Indonesia and in China, which are also ploughed. You know, they're flooded and ploughed at different times. And these are all transformations of the Earth's surface. The fact that we think of them as rural and somehow countrified, and we kind of oppose that to the city, don't we? We think of them as urban, cities as urban, somehow opposed to the countryside, which is rural or non-urban. But actually, there's this industrialization of the countryside has been going on for a long time, where soils have been really radically transformed. But crucially, they haven't become entirely, any more than rivers, they haven't become entirely an artificial entity. So they're still a mixture of human and non-human forces. So you've still got like lots of creatures there, like earthworms, who are all too happy to make their home in this plough soil that's being churned over all the time by the plough, again and again, in sort of rhythmic fashion, almost like seasonally.
Yeah. No, for me it's really fascinating because I am only—I told you—only since 6 months in Switzerland.
Yeah.
And I really wanted to end up there, and it was a reason for it. And the reason is that somehow city life does not play a very important role in the way that they structure culture, or in the way that they understand their own territorium.
Yeah.
And for me, it was very important to try to surpass the avant-garde, which is again something that has to do with with how I do see contemporary art, or the art production of today, as we do have a necessity to go away from the imaginative parameters that were set in the modern times. And it's very difficult for us to overcome the 20th century and the 19th to the 20th century. So the city still represents the place of culture. And then like the rural area represents something which is in opposition to it.
Sure.
But it has been given in art a transformation that our cities are unable to actually sustain artistic production. They are too expensive for artists to live in or to actually produce from the cities. Yeah. The pressure, politically speaking, makes that our art centers also need to do exhibitions that appeal to the majority in a way that they are kind of render, if not completely relevant, but less relevant to the communities that produce art, as being some sort of free academies for further thinking into your field. So somehow the rural or the non-city, it's super relevant, and it's becoming more and more relevant, but there is no there is no vocabulary to talk about it. So when you are talking about the rivers, and that's why I was fascinated, you are talking about this kind of hybridity that takes place in a really complex way outside places, in that archaeological sites per se, or prototypical ways of understanding where culture takes place. So you are kind of giving us a model with the river model to actually think about how to go away of the obvious dense cultural sites.
It's strange, isn't it, that we think of culture as being centered in the city and in the institutions of the city, like the museums and art galleries. But actually, the very word agriculture itself embodies the word culture, and the idea is there of that ground itself can be cultured, you know, that can mm-hmm. be cultivated,
yep.
so to speak. So although we tend to think of the city as cultured and the countryside as somehow uncultured, that actually our language about it reflects a much older way of thinking about things, where actually the countryside can be cultured. You can have cultured ground, you can have cultivated ground, and but cultivated has come to mean just the sort of rural.
Yeah, but what thing. I think also that's very important that comes across in your text is that your notion of culture is different from when in the field of art and contemporary art in particular, we have been very shaped by cultural studies. Yeah. And the word culture tends to nominate rational thinking, argumentatively structured in a way that superimpose the human way of thinking upon what is non-human.
Sure.
So when you are talking about cultivated grounds or cultivated territories or rivers, I think that the way that you are using culture is kind of, is much more weird. It's almost, it's hinting something else. You know, you still use that word because it's the word we have, but you are presenting us with something which is like, is beyond culture.
It's beyond our normal conceptions of what we think of as culture.
Yeah.
So the very idea of a river, for example, as material culture, there's something about that idea that is quite subversive and quite, I wouldn't say shocking, but people mm-hmm. would disagree with it. And they'd say, oh, hang on, a table or a glass or a chair, that's all material culture, artworks are material culture, but a river, how can that be? And yet you can clearly see when you look at rivers and the history of rivers how they've been shaped by human beings, and not just in a utilitarian way mm-hmm. but you know, to extract the energy, but also to create beautiful river vistas with embankments and promenades and bandstands and you know, I'm thinking of Paris and walking by the Seine, and the Thames in England. It's got like embankments going along the side.
Yeah.
And all these rivers are very much modified by human beings, but at the same time, people are radically affected by rivers themselves.
Yeah, by the rivers themselves, yeah.
And so it's not all going in one direction.
And are you aware of thing, or what do you think about this new interest of art in your field, or in I think, you know, the talking about matter. I think I was part of the Documenta team, and one section of the exhibition was called The Brain, but everything was kind of emanating from matter.
Yeah.
And we are here also in kind of a cultural art.
Yeah.
Context. So what do you think about this new interest that is coming from contemporary art versus people like you or your field?
I feel a complete affinity with the sort of approaches that artists take. I mean, my impression is that many works of art are somehow intrinsically archaeological. And archaeologists can draw many, so I'm thinking, for example, of landscape art or the work of someone like Andy Goldsworthy.
Mm-hmm.
He works with like rocks and stones, and he builds flowing forms, walls and sheepfolds, and he's interested in materials. You know, there's a fundamental interest in matter there.
But
that
not
we
only
share,
not only
see.
Those. I think that now there's a big interest. I was trying to come up with a reason for that. And I've been speculating with the fact that, you know, the way that culture has been historically relating to politics had a very important moment in 68 and in, you know, and in all this in that historical point, but also these notions mostly and like embedded into Foucault philosophy and the question of action. So, you know, if art is not pure aesthetics, then it's action. If it's action, it does something.
Yeah,
if it does something, it changes. If it changes, it changes the social. If it changes, the social needs to be now, because you need to be a witness. As a witness of the art, you need to be also be able to be the witness of the change that art produces. But then all of a sudden, we discover that even if this is a completely legitimate wish and dream, and it's a way of articulating a relationship in between individual action and material culture, the culture and the social does not change just because of an intended action. So the action is intended to change, but change may not happen, or it may happen, but 100 years after, or even did happen, but 100 years before. So, and I think that this new interest in culture has to do with the fact that then, instead of focusing on action and individual action, we are trying to understand the other side of the story, which is matter. So if we are unable to control action, perhaps we need to invest in understanding matter. Independently of, you know, the obvious landscape art and so on and so forth. Like,
but isn't it the case that because we've given in the past so much credence to kind of ideas over matter, perhaps neglected matter, that going along with that, there's the there was the idea that somehow matter was passive and inert somehow, and I think what's coming through is the realization that matter is not just passive and inert. And I think artists are playing a large part in this. In the matter is coming through as something that actually has an energy and a power to influence things of its own. It's not inert and passive at all.
But that goes back to when I was saying that you are really kind of revolutionizing the notion of culture, because if you are saying that we have been given power to ideas upon matter, we are already being dualists. I think there is a dualist view of the world that is actually what annoys me of all this era thinking. There is some kind of agency that departs from one direction, acts in another direction. And this is a dualistic view. So there's still very few ways of understanding why action would affect matter, or why it would affect in a synchronized way. So, but we kind of have now the intuition that matter may think, or there is a way of giving consciousness to matter. And this is like, you know, counterintuitive. I think a rock is not thinking as I do, but
it's interesting in that respect to think of the artistic process. And I mean, as well as being an archaeologist, I come from a kind of anthropological background. And I used to be really interested in primitive art. And as an archaeologist, I feel an affinity with, for example, Eskimo artists, who they have this notion that when they carve something out of walrus bone or whatever material they're working with, that they're not necessarily applying a form onto the material, that what they're actually doing is releasing a form from the material, and that there's something there in the matter already which one only has to kind of uncover and it will emerge into the world, so to speak. And it's like a different kind of world view. But
even in animism, there is a dualistic view, meaning if you are like, if you follow the new writings on consciousness. Yeah. Many people are trying to find out a way to overcome this dualism, so that it's not only something we imagine, or not even something that we reverse. I think, of course, we don't only impose, but we release. And matter is also teaching us. But the interesting thing would be if there is some sort of quantum relationship in between individuals and matter, which is quantic. So the entanglement would happen, but it's unintended in both ends. Yep. So the rock has no intention to talk to me, and I have no intention to impose a thinking into the rock because I don't have magical thinking or mythical thinking. Yeah. But still,
I'm sure that on a quantum level. Many, not only that kind of division, but many divisions that we perceive and experience in the everyday world would break down completely. But
also in archaeology?
Sure. But there's another sense in which matter can think, and that is, if you think of human beings are increasingly becoming not just a biological organism, but also they're incorporating technology into their very being. So at the moment we're kind of wired up, and these wires and microphones and everything have become like a part of us. We have these extensions going out into the world which go along sort of fiber optic cables and things, and our brain, a bit like your conception of the octopus, which has this sort of decentralized brain distributed throughout its body and in each tentacles. We're a bit like that now, because our brain is distributed through computer networks and internet and these kind of things. And the extent to which technology has incorporated itself into the human body and the human mind is like a trend which can only continue. And that entanglement of technology and what we used to think of as natural forms, or the human and the non-human, is how do you then separate whether it's the human thinking or the machine, because you're not really dealing with a human, you're dealing with a hybrid entity.
Yeah,
who's
but
both
perhaps we don't even need to separate.
No, the question then becomes irrelevant, really. So
it is the analytic, kind of analytic method that needs to separate in order to gain distance, in order to come to a conclusion. But I think if we would embrace a much more complex logic, then separation is not necessarily the way to go. And that's the same with culture and nature, matter and the human, and so on and so forth. And that's why I thought that your view on archaeology is interesting, because you are actually introducing archaeology at the core of what we need to understand what's going on.
And do you think, Chus, that it's also the case that this is what an artist does, that in a sense a contemporary artist is subverting our views of nature and culture and mind over matter? Is that what, in part, contemporary art is about? I mean, I see that there's something in contemporary art, looking in from the outside, that in a sense is quite anachronistic, and that it's it can actually make us think of things in a different way, because it's partly subversive. It's taking something from here and putting it in a context where it doesn't belong.
Yeah, it has a rather complex history, because on the one hand we inherit, I think, art is at the core of our cultural and historical understanding of experience. Yeah. So, and the sensorium, like how do you think when you sense, when you experience something. Yeah. So one way historically of addressing that is, of course, aesthetic experience and beauty.
Yeah.
Art is also a production, so it has been completely into all the systems that try to explain production in economic and social terms, and therefore it's also at the core of the transformation of our notions of consumption, and so on and so forth. But I do think that, I believe that really art is really helping us to produce new ways of dealing with consciousness and the relationships in plural that we may establish with intelligences and knowledges that are unintended. And I think that one of our big problems is that because we are humans, we think that thought, in order to be relevant, needs to be intended. So intentionality is what structure our way of communication and to actually be rigorous in the world. So I think art actually has other ways which are unintended, but are and it's exactly the trust into the unintended intelligences that we don't find in any other field.
I
think what is any other field that would trust in unintended knowledge or thought?
Yeah.
And I think that we are at the very, very beginning of trying to understand that.
You have a wonderful phrase which is really memorable. You describe contemporary artists as strangers to time, escaping the wanderings of the present. And when I read that, I thought, there's that notion of the anachronistic there, the moving from one time, the displacement in time, you know, the artist kind of partly out of time or out of time context.
Yeah.
And or taking an object from one time.
So we are finishing?
Five minutes. Yeah, okay.
It's really interesting. I was appointed curator of contemporary art museum in Barcelona. So all of a sudden I was confronted with the word contemporary, but I did not want to use it. So I needed to justify why I thought that to use the word contemporary, the notion of the contemporariness was too narrow of a notion. It was actually implying something that is something commonsensical. So the audience of an exhibition of contemporary art assumes that you are synchronic with what you are seeing. So the audience listening to us, or if you are going to an exhibition, you assume that you are there at the same time that the works are there. But the time of the works is completely different from the biological time of the viewer, but also is completely really different in nature.
So there is an
immense asynchronicity. And then on the other hand, the industry, from the Industrial Revolution on, but now with technology, insists on synchronicity. Synchronicity is a way of making you aware fast of the transmission that you may establish in between the object and yourself.
And it's also in the arguments about the Anthropocene as well, where synchronicity is a kind of key issue, really, where I think geologists are arguing that you have to have this precisely synchronous boundary to mark the start.
But I don't think, I think that synchronicity is a big problem.
For example, I've just written a paper arguing that you can't really impose this synchronous entity, this moment in time, this instant, onto a what's manifestly a kind of time transgressive world, which where processes often have no beginning that you can identify, you know, one moment, but there are actually many moments that you could say is a beginning. And why do you need a beginning anyway?
Because I suppose that we are very bound to the notion of actuality, that we need to be actual. Because if the audience would not get the sense that they are actual, then their very notion of presence and relevance in you know, cultural and biological terms would kind of vanish. So we are not given a better language or a better a vocabulary to address, you know, this complex relationship that surpasses synchronicity.
Sure, yeah.
I think they're going to
I guess that's finish. Coming to the end, isn't it? Sorry. Well, shall we, do you know, it's been really great talking to you. Thank you. I've been very honoured to talk to you.
Same here. Thank you so much. Pleasure.
Thanks.